I suggest you study this.
The views and opinions expressed on the Faygoluvers Podcast do not necessarily reflect those of us here at Faygoluvers.net. Some episodes may contain disturbing content. Discretion is advised.
There is a lot of goo goo dolls here. GGD live goo. Wow. I'm taking music criticism from a proud member of the Juggalo Nation. Faygoluvers. 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 Faygoluvers.
What's up, Juggalos, and welcome to this very special Christmas episode of the Faygoluvers Podcast. I'm your homie Rosco. I'm going to be your host for this very special Christmas episode of the Faygoluvers Podcast. I am currently sitting back by the fireplace, not really, drinking a pineapple Faygo. I just had Christmas dinner, so I am content and I am set to go, and my mind is 100% focused on this podcast. Hells yeah. We have our homie Daddy Longlegs on this episode of the podcast, and just forewarning that this interview might be a little bit more explicit than past interviews on the podcast, but fuck it, if you're listening to this podcast, odds are you're used to explicit material anyways. And he actually tells us sort of what I consider to be sort of a sad story, a sad Christmas story that happened to him. So yeah, just continue listening to hear that shit, ninjas. Also on this episode of the Faygoluvers Podcast, we are going to be talking with our homie King Lucem Ferre. That's right. And for you ninjas who don't know King Lucem, he is the dude who makes the beats for this podcast. He made like the intro for the podcast. And ironically, I'm featuring his interview on an episode where he didn't actually make the beats that you're hearing in the background. I actually just jacked some Christmas shit from online because it's a Christmas episode, right? But listen to pretty much any other episode of the Faygoluvers Podcast, and the beats that you hear playing in the background that you don't recognize, pretty much all of those are King Lucem's. So yeah, continue listening to hear that interview. We're going to get into the news pretty much right off the hop, but before we do, there's a couple things that I want to mention. First of all, that infomercial that's going to be dropping on Psychopathic Records. This Thursday on the Christmas episode of the Juggalo Show, Jumpsteady actually spoke on that infomercial a little bit. And I for some reason, I just thought it was kind of important that we let you ninjas know what Jumpsteady had to say on the infomercial. It's not very long. Check it out.
Also, like, I wanted to point out that this is so weird. I feel like I'm talking to myself at this point. But I want to point out that at the beginning of the new year, there's gonna be a new infomercial that we're launching that features our entire roster. For that we're rolling into the new year with, as well as a song done by the entire Psychopathic family. So there's been a lot of work put into this and a lot of love put into this. And it really is a super positive. It's not, I don't even know what if you can call it an infomercial. It's just a super positive message that's going to be delivered to the Juggalo world, you know, through all of our artists and everything. And, you know, it's just karmically, it's been very fulfilling working on this directly myself, as well as ICP has had a big hand in it. So it's not even like an announcement of what's coming up. It's more just like it's basically detailing the flavor of 2017 and motivating everybody to get out there. To fight the good fight, you know, in the Juggalo March and just in general.
Something else I wanted to mention before we got into the news was that our homie G-Mo Ski's album, My Filthy Spirit Bomb, actually hit the Billboard charts, and it actually hit the Billboard Top 200, which is very, very dope. 191 it hit. So he charted, so props G-Mo Ski. Also, he got number 4 on the top rap, number 9 on the top independent, and number 91 on the top albums. So dope shit. Congrats, G-Mo Ski. One last thing that I want to mention before we get into the news is that Violent J and Shaggy 2 Dope are going to be holding a Rude Boy benefit show. Hells yeah, and tickets are on sale right now. Check out the link in the show notes for those. That shit is going down on February 24th at the Majestic Theater in Detroit, Michigan. And of course, that's going to feature solo sets from Violent J and Shaggy 2 Dope. You don't want to miss that shit. Alright, homies. Christmas episode of the Faygoluvers Podcast. Let's just get into the news. Christmas news. Oh,
because it's Christmas, you know what I mean? You gotta hook stuff up, right?
I won't make no Christmas music, even if you'd listen to it. I won't make no Christmas songs, and if you think this is one, bitch, you're wrong.
Here's my reason to be jolly. I'm fucked up and my girl just called me. She coming home straight to the flow and suck my dick under mistletoe. What you thought? I was gonna make a nice song just because it's Christmas? Wrong. The season's here and at the end of the year I could use a beer and a hit up a bong. Wish list, what you fucking want for Christmas? Some gift shit, money and video game system. Stuff stockings up with toys and little candy cane dreams for the girls and boys. I just wanna blaze by the Christmas tree. And you want a new holiday song from me? Fuck that. So if you think that that's what I'ma make, well I ain't, and Santa Claus is fake, little bitch. Your parents work mad hard all year, bringing in money, watch it disappear. By January, they in credit card debt. But you don't give a fuck, cause you got your shit. While you open up gifts, I open up fillies. Fill them up with weed and get so silly, really. And if you motherfuckers can't feel me, take a hit off this blunt and see what the deal be. Christmas, nope, I won't rap about it. I just won't do it.
Man, I seriously doubt it.
I won't.
What the fuck you rapping about now?
Shit, I guess I put a Christmas song out. I won't make no Christmas music, even if you'd listen to it. I won't make no Christmas songs, and if you think this is one, bitch, you're wrong. I won't make no Christmas music, even if you'd listen to it. I won't make no Christmas songs, and if you think this is one, bitch, you're wrong.
So the first piece of news that we're going to go over on this Christmas episode of the Faygoluvers Podcast is that ICP, Brother Lynch Hung, Lil Eazy-E, and DJ Yella are all set to perform at the upcoming Las Vegas Hemp Fest in April of 2017, April 1st, 2017, at the Craig Ranch Regional Park. The event's going to be hosted by the Wax Pack, and check this out. Lil Eazy-E and DJ Yella are going to be performing classics from NWA, like NWA classic tracks. So even if you're not into the whole like weed scene or anything like that, it's worth hitting up this event just to see that shit. Like, holy shit. Let alone ICP and Brother Lynch Hung, right? The event's gonna have free weed, free dabs, and snowboarding. Hit up LasVegasHempFest.com for more details, and to pick up your tickets, check out the link in the show notes of this episode. Next! Our homie Kidcrusher is going to be doing an AMA and Ask Me Anything on Reddit on January 4th at 7 p.m. Eastern. These ninjas at the Juggalo subreddit, found at reddit.com/r/juggalo, did receive confirmation from Kidcrusher that he was ready and willing to come on and answer any and all questions that his fans and Juggalos had for him. You can find that shit at the link in the show notes for this episode. Also, you can submit a question in advance if you like. Also, check out the links in the show notes for this Christmas episode of the Faygoluvers Podcast. And I just want to say, too, when it comes to Kidcrusher, this ninja is the shit, and I'm very proud to say that we did feature some of his Christmas music in this Christmas episode of the Faygoluvers Podcast, which is dope, including the song that you're hearing right now.
Like a humbug, I've lost my mind on this deadly night. I see the star right up in the sky. It's fucking red, it's not white, I'm possessed.
Now I am going to fucking kill you. I'm gonna fucking kill you.
Some very important details have been announced about the upcoming Games Convention, the 2017 Games Convention that most of you Juggalos know as the Dart Carnival Games Con. We have some dates, April 21st, 22nd, and 23rd at the Gibraltar Trade Center in Mount Clemens, Michigan. And I laugh because this is literally like the fifth take I've done because I could not pronounce Gibraltar before. I seem to be doing fine now. There's going to be games like Into the Equicide, Quest for Shangri-La, Texas Hold'em. That's I know me personally, that's where I would be probably the whole time. Morton's List, Magic the Gathering, and of course the new game, Juggalos Against Humanity, or Juggalos Against Sanity, depending on what they're going to call it. I guess they haven't decided yet. But either way, that shit should be dope. Check that out, Juggalos. Unfortunately, on the Faygoluvers Podcast, there is those one or two news stories that could be considered negative that we do talk about. And I like to think that Faygoluvers.net and the podcast itself, and even on the forum and everything involved with Faygoluvers, for the most part, is positive. But, you know, being an underground news website, you can't just exclude the negative news a lot of the time, and especially on this podcast. However, this news, although negative, does have a positive effect by me talking about it, because this is, for the most part, it's about juggalos that are down on their luck during the holiday season. I know there's a lot of people out there that are down on their luck during the holiday season. I like to think that, especially with juggalos, family kind of takes care of each other, right? And although I know we can't take care of every single juggalo that's hurting during the holiday season, especially, you know, with a lot of us we're having our own financial issues and whatnot, there are those select few people that can. So if you can't help out by donating, if you can't help out financially, then maybe share this on your Facebook or your Twitter, because there could be some people out there that could help out some of these juggalos. So check out the link in the show notes for that. It's called Juggalos Down on Their Luck. Click the link, read some of the stories from some of these ninjas. Some of them are very heartfelt, and help out some of these ninjas so that they can have a Merry Christmas. The more I remember that fateful night when you lost your life, and ever since then in my heart, Christmas don't feel right. So this is some dope news that I actually debated on whether or not I should talk about this on the podcast, but it's about toys, and this is a Christmas episode, so I thought, why the fuck not? Twisted announced on their Facebook that next year, on TwistedShop.com, they're going to be selling Ninja Buddies. Ninja Buddies are like those old school wrestling buddies from like the 90s, or like late 80s, early 90s, I guess they were. So like they had like the Hulk Hogan Ninja Buddy, and the Macho Man Randy Savage Ninja Buddy, and they were basically like stuffed animals, sort of. And do you ninjas know what I'm talking about? Either way, they're doing this magic ninja style, and the picture that they showed on their Facebook showed Madrox, Monoxide, Blaze, and Boondocks. Hells yeah, I wonder if they're gonna do like a Lex the Hexmaster or Jimo Ski. That'd be dope too. But either way, check out the link in the show notes if you want to see a picture of those, and we'll keep you posted as to when they'll be available for purchase. So this is the first of what I consider to be two bombs that are going to be dropping in the news segment of this Christmas episode of the Faygoluvers Podcast. Check it out. There has been lots of details announced about the upcoming Juggalo March on Washington and the website that's going to be accessible on January 1st, juggalomarch.com. Big shout out to Violent J, who was a guest on Thursday's episode of the Juggalo Show, the Christmas episode of the Juggalo Show. And he did have a lot to say about the Juggalo March, and more specifically the website, I guess. But check it out. They're sending out over 200 invites to artists that have major Juggalo affiliations and are supported by Juggalos. And they're inviting them to perform at the march. Every single invite is going to be personalized. That means they're not just a generic invite. So it's like the example that Jay was giving on the Juggalo Show was like Jelly Roll. So he would write like, "Hey Jelly Roll, what's going on? Loved the new album, blah blah blah. So anyways, we're having this march," like shit like that, you know what I'm saying? So they're giving them, the artists, they're giving them 90 days to respond to the invitation. If they do not respond to the invitation in 90 days, which is 3 months, like you know, that's plenty of time to respond, then they are going to consider that as the artist declining the invitation. They're going to have a list of the artists on the website, and if the artist accepts, you're going to see a little yellow diamond beside their name. And if they decline, you're going to see a red X beside their name. All right, check this out as well. Every single artist that accepts to take part in the march is going to be part of a huge rap cipher that's going to be going on. It's going to be recorded and it's going to be filmed. And it's going to be a fucking huge rap cipher, depending on how many artists are going to show up. But I have a feeling it's going to be probably... I could be way off, I could be totally wrong, but I have a feeling at least half of the people that they're going to invite, at least half, so that's like 100 artists, so that's going to be a huge fucking rap cipher. Wow. The website is also going to feature lots of examples of Juggalo hate and discrimination because of the FBI gang label, stories and like just, you know, footage, shit like that, and they're also going to have editorials written by well-known authors. Check that shit out. Also, a Juggalo March wish list, where I believe that means you can kind of submit an artist, and if they can track down their information, then they will get invited to the march. Everything's going to be mapped out on the website, what artist is going to be performing where, all that good shit. I don't know if it's going to be up as soon as the site launches, or if they're still waiting on on artists back if they already sent out the invitations. I wasn't 100% clear on that either, but wow. Either way, homies, January 1st, New Year's Day, hit up juggalomarch.com. Check it out. This is going to be the second bomb that I'm dropping in the new segment of this Christmas episode of the Faygoluvers Podcast. Magic Ninja Entertainment is going to be announcing a new artist on Christmas Day. And depending on when you're listening to this, you probably already know the new artist. Because I've seen the statistics for this podcast, and I know that most ninjas listen to it a day or two after it comes out. So, I'm currently recording this on Christmas Eve. I don't know who the artist is. You probably do know who the artist is. I've heard speculation from everything from Young Wicked to Kung Fu Vampire to just some ridiculous shits. This artist is going to be releasing also free downloadable songs, plural. So maybe like a mixtape or some shit. Maybe just some shit that they wanted to release. We don't know. Or I don't know right now. You probably know, Ninja. Either way, Christmas Day, 3 p.m., hit up Magic Ninja Entertainment's Facebook page for that information. All right, homies, we're going to get into the short interview that we did with our homie King Lucem. Going to take a short Christmas commercial break, and then we're going to get into our interview with our homie Daddy Longlegs. Stick around.
Or planning or scheming or scamming, just me with an axe and I'm quietly standing. With me facing your back, you're just texting and laughing, and I'm double-handed grabbing an axe and start smashing. Witnesses are gasping while I put all the pieces in a bag in the trunk, hit the gas, now I'm back in the cut trying to dab as much blood off a foot.
Got Rosco here, and I am here with the one and only King Lucem, the ninja who the music that you hear playing right now in the background, music created. How the hell are you, brother?
I'm doing fine. How are you?
I'm doing fine as well. Thanks for coming on and talking to me for this little segment of the podcast. I appreciate that.
No problem, man. Hey, do you want to know the size of my dick?
No, no, I'm just fucking around. You told me not to ask that, brother.
You did, but... I couldn't resist.
Oh, you might as well tell
us
all
now. Hey, you
want
to know the size of my dick?
No, I'm fucking with you.
I've never officially measured it, but somewhere, I think, around 7 inches.
So, yeah, you're supposed to just estimate, right? And then just, like, add an inch?
No, well, no, that's not what I have. I don't know. I'm just estimating. I don't add an inch. Okay, it's 8 inches around there?
All right. See. So you get the concept of it now.
Yeah.
So what's going on, brother? So you create music.
I try. If you could call it music.
Well, I don't know, man. It's pretty dope, man. The music that you created for the podcast definitely fits with the format, like, perfectly.
No problem.
Ninjas that need to know, the intro music also was created by Lucem. So basically anything that you don't recognize on the podcast is probably created by Lucem. So when was it that you got interested in making beats and shit like that?
I can pinpoint that moment. I was always interested in doing art stuff, and I don't know, I like when I was really young, I always looked up to Eminem and kind of wanted to be Eminem.
So then you just kind of felt like you needed to get creative with the music then?
Yeah.
So like what programs and shit do you use for it then?
FL.
Oh, Fruity Loops.
Yep.
Dope. Have you ever heard of Sonar?
I don't think I have. So many people have thrown around different program names. Reaper, Sonar, Cubase.
So you're on Faygoluvers quite a bit. So what got you interested in the underground? When did you first start listening to that style of music, that type of music?
I don't.
I just pretend.
No. I think sometime when I was around 12, I think. When I first heard of ICP, a friend played a set, man. And from there on, I was like just huge into ICP.
And then just started getting into all the other acts and underground labels and shit like that too?
Yeah.
This is the Christmas episode, so do you have any plans for tomorrow on Christmas?
No. Well, I mean, because other than, like, spend time with family, I guess, if I have to, Christmas has always been, like, more of, like, a kid's holiday, you know? You get the kids shit, and I don't like kids.
Right.
So I don't want to be around the kids. I like my niece. She's cool, but other kids suck.
Okay, I hear ya. I like my niece, too, yeah.
Told me the most brilliant thing ever the other day. She's all like, if I were a vampire, she's only like 5 or 4. She's like, if I were a vampire, I would shoot all the people and then eat the blood with a spoon.
Oh, shit. It's kind of dark, eh? How old is she?
Yeah, I was proud. I think she's like 4 or 5.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I was going to get her a Build-A-Bear, like a zombie Build-A-Bear thing, but...
Oh, dope.
They don't do that kind of thing, so...
Oh, well, what about Lucem, though? What are you hoping on getting for Christmas?
I don't know. I just... Money, I guess? I don't know. Yeah, so you get to a certain age, I don't know, it's just, that's what you like, you know, you just spend the money on the kids, you don't really... Because you're an adult, you spend money on yourself, and if you really want something, you just buy it yourself, so...
Right. No, I hear you, man. Well, that's still, man, if somebody wants to pay my bills or my insurance for Christmas, that'll work too, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, but man, I don't know, man. There's always that one thing I want, like,
Oh, Christmas blowjob.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that will work too. But no, man, like, I wanted, like, a vinyl player, so I got, like, a dope, it's like a vinyl player. You can plug it into your laptop, and you can actually record your vinyls. It's really dope.
I was looking at record players the other day. I was going to get a record player, wanted to get To Pimp a Butterfly and 808s and Heartbreak on record.
To Pimp a Butterfly?
Yeah, Kendrick Lamar.
Oh, Kendrick, okay.
Yeah.
Not 100%.
I got a bone to pick.
Oh, is that? I think I know that song. Do they play that shit on the radio?
I'm not sure. I don't listen to too much radio.
Okay.
The monkey mouth motherfucker sitting in my throne again. I'm mad. He mad. But I ain't stressing. 2 friends. 1 question. Bitch, where are you when I was walking? Now I run the game with the whole world talking King Lucem. Everybody want to cut their legs off him. Lucem. White man taking no losses. Oh, yeah. That'll be my next project. I'm just going to cover Kendrick Lamar's song.
Oh, dope, man. Thank you so much for coming on and talking to me on the Christmas episode. Is there anything you want to let the fans know before we take off?
I do have a project out called There Is Something Wrong. It is $12. I was going to charge about $85, but people told me not to. It would be somewhere at Lucem Fair. I don't know, I don't know the fucking... URL for it. It's on Bandcamp/Lucem Fair.
Send me that link. We'll put it in the description of the podcast so people can find it there.
Another thing I wanted to mention was the intro for it was from the song Faygo Remembers from the mixtape called Postmortem Boredom, which was created by a bunch of people through the forums.
Oh, I didn't even know that, brother. I thought that it was like original.
Yeah, I made it original for that mixtape, but awesome. I was like, you know, that would be a dope intro for this. It fits pretty well.
Oh, man, it fits perfectly, man. We love it. And you know what? One thing I got to ask, man, about that intro, too, I guess, while we're talking about it. You got Shaggy saying Faygoluvers. What's the next voice that we're hearing, and what's he saying?
It's Shaggy again going, Faygoluvers.
Oh, Faygoluvers. Oh, snap.
Yeah.
Fuck, I just learned something. Okay, dope. All right, well, thank you so much, King Lucem, for coming on and talking to me on this Christmas episode.
Hey, no problem at all. Thank you for having me.
Every fucking year, man. Every year. Gotta deal with this bullshit. What are we, 5? Like, come on. I'm gonna have to fucking kill all y'all bitches.
Time to eat. Dinner served. Let's take a seat.
table, I will feast human meat with collard greens I'm murdering. I do this every year, I like to spread the cheer. You can call me Santa when I'm dancing on a prancer motherfucker in the oven, let's make it clear. Are you ready for a guy like me? With a hand on a guy I be. Ready for a sucker, any motherfucker coming out of cannibal sea. It's Christmas Eve. Got a dinner in the oven in my kitchen. Motherfuckers getting cooked up a chicken. Little bit of Zans for the hand of the man that is planned to please all the fam that is wishing. That day we're invited to dinner to be a sinner. Eat the liver with a dead broad breadwinner. But I'ma get her in a minute. I'ma hit her in the liver with a sliver of glass and I'ma kill her. It's a supper where I cover all the evidence. Cut the lines to the phone of your residence. Understand if you a little bit hesitant. But all the meals I prepare are decadent. So I serve up the plates of the steak. Human flanks, what I made, no mistake, what you ate. Don't debate about your fate, I'ma take your life away. Don't fucking play, Christmas Day's gonna pay. That's how it is, man. Fuck all the children. Santa's dead inside the crib, fam. Blood all over the ceiling. Sit down, listen to me now. I will not let you down. Cannibal has come to town. Are you ready to die? Sit down, listen to me now. I will not let you down. Cannibal has come to town. Are you ready to die?
What up, though, motherfuckers? It's me, Sweet Sugar Slam, up in this bitch with some serious super live freshness. In case you ain't noticed, it's that special time of year. A time for sharing, caring, and getting drunk as fucking blew out. Woo! But did you know the suicide rate more than doubles this time of year? Yes, it does, bitch. Real talk. That's because motherfuckers can't pay the rent, the heat bill is extra fat, the back left window don't roll up, and on top of that, the fucking kids want shit. They want mad shit. Shit like extra expensive super Wii's and nuclear Nerf guns. It's enough to drive anybody over the edge. I believe it's important for all of us to lend a hand wherever possible. Even if you ain't got shit yourself, it still feels good to give to someone who needs shit worse than you. Especially the kids, man. Give to the fucking kids. Don't be a dick.
Hello, I can hear your breathing.
Was that too loud? I'm so sorry.
You
I'm
okay
so sorry.
Over there? Who is this?
Are you wearing pants? You don't have to tell me.
Yeah, I'm wearing pants. Who's calling? Who is this?
Can you just play with it a little bit? But you don't have to if you don't want to. It's okay. No, really.
I know what this is.
Yeah.
I think you got the wrong number, but maybe I could help you out.
Yeah?
Yeah, so what are you wearing?
A panda hat and flip-flops.
That's hot. So you want to take off that panda hat and take that hand?
Yeah, yeah.
Run it down your stomach, down your thigh?
Yeah.
Grab that junk of yours? And go fuck yourself, asshole.
Grandma?
Welcome back to the Faygoluvers Podcast. Homie Rosco here, and I am here with the one and only Daddy Longlegs.
There's actually two of me, but that doesn't count.
There's two of you.
Yeah, so I've been told. There's another Daddy Longlegs on the internet who plays folk music, and somehow people think I'm appearing places, and I'm not.
I'm here with one of the Daddy Longlegs. How are you, brother?
I'm doing good. Spread thin, as usual. You know, getting to the season of the year where things get really, really busy and chaotic, but I'm good.
Hells yeah, man. Well, I want to thank you so much for coming on the Faygoluvers Podcast and talking to me.
Of course, man. Of course. Anything for Faygoluvers. You guys and Scotty, come on, man. We'll go way back.
Hells yeah, man. All right, so just right out the gate, man. I just want to ask you about this new web store that got launched.
Okay, so we launched. So this is pretty much one of four or five giant projects we have in motion. And we launched a little while ago a brand new web store, which is sugardaddymerch.com and, of course, wolfpackmerch.com. They both go to the same place. Or you can just go to wolf.com and literally click on the merch button, and it'll go there, too. And basically, what we've done is we've been going through growing pains. Merchandise has been going faster than we can sort of make it or sort of cover it in all sorts of weird sizes. So we partnered up with this very big company out by us, and you know, we've been just blasting all this new merchandise out left and right that we weren't able to do on our own power. We are an independent. We've run this company since the Bloodhoung Gang days out of my basement in Sugar Daddy Productions. Back then it was called Cheese Factory Records, and we've done that same thing now with Wolfpac, and you know, pretty much it's all independently done. And it's gotten to the point where we just had to sort of go to that next level, man, those growing pains, which, you know, we're blessed to have such problems, you know what I mean?
But, and you guys have some custom shit on that web store too, right?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Well, so what's happening is there's the stuff that we put out, you know, we've got shirt logos from, you know, years ago, the classics that everybody likes, all this brand new stuff that people are just, you know, they're digging. The Wolfpac vibe is always obviously a little tongue-in-cheek, a little offensive, a little dark, you know, a little weird. And then we've got a bunch of made-to-order stuff, which is great. So you can literally go on there. You know, back in the day, we couldn't offer you a Wolfpac hockey jersey, but now we can. So you can get a customized Wolfpac hockey jersey within, I think they say, 10 days. It's made to order. Boom. And the quality, that's the other thing, is by going to this new level, the quality is so much better, like what we're able to offer, because these guys that we've partnered with are just pros. They're just pros. And, you know, it just came to the point where it's like, you know, you can record something in your home studio, but when you go out to do a regular gig, when you go to a big studio, you know, I can't afford the $10,000 preamp in the big studio. You know what I'm saying? Or the
right.
$3,000 microphone so I can, you know, spit on it and abuse it in the way I can. So you go to the real studio sooner or later. You know what I mean? Like, you've got to step up. So it was just time. So we launched it, and it's been doing, we popped this thing online and it started moving stuff already, so that's kind of cool. I don't know if it's just my parents buying stuff, which is cool. I'm all right with that. You know, if mom wants to just rewrap it and give it back to me for Christmas, I'm cool with a new Wolfpac hoodie, because Lord knows I probably can't afford one, but that's okay. You know, it's all good.
All right, brother, so I'm going to ask you the generic question. How did Wolfpac come about? How did you guys get started?
Well, while we were doing the Bloodhound Gang, you know, me and Jimmy Pop started the Bloodhound Gang in my basement. We did that for a little while. And we got a lot of traction pretty quick. And it started going good. And there was a lot of stuff going on. And as it was going, it started moving. Me and Jim are still good friends to this day, but we both come from different schools. I come from a New York City hardcore meets New York City hip hop. So while I was going to like CBGB's, seeing things like Gorilla Biscuits and Judge and Sick of It All, groups like that, I was also going to like Union Square and like the park and the bridge and seeing like, you know, Boogie Down Productions. And, you know, I went to school with fucking Biz Markie, you know, like, so those were my two worlds. Where Jim's worlds were kind of like new wave and a lot of like, a lot of European stuff, which is good stuff. Don't get me wrong. I do love my Erasure and Depeche Mode as well. But, Jim kind of comes from that Euro vibe. And, you know, he started going the one way. I started going more to the other way. Meet a couple of the other members, like MSG. Skipoponymous decided to kind of go off and do our own thing. And Jim went off and did his thing. And that's what we basically did. You know, we brought the harder, you know, the name Bloodhound Gang was a goof because there's nothing ganging about any of us. You know, we're not tough guys. And then on top of it, it comes from a show called 3-2-1 Contact where it was these kids. Did you ever see 3-2-1 Contact?
No, I've never even heard of it, no.
It's like a Sesame Street that they play in the States. It's horrible, and it's like it's old. And they were like, there was a show on it called The Bloodhound Gang, and there was like three kids, and of course they were like in Brooklyn or something, and they solved crimes using like math and science. They were like Excelsior! It was like the start of like the worst Simpsons episode you ever could imagine, and that was called The Bloodhound Gang. That's where we got the name. So the name now was, you go to the same element, so let's go a little bit the same, but harder, faster, more aggressive. So Bloodhound Gang evolved into Wolfpac. And the concept behind Wolfpac was just to make it a constantly changing, evolving thing. Because when we were in the Bloodhound Gang, we had members who would sort of sidetrack us or hold us hostage. You know, we don't want to play that event, or we want to do this. And, you know, they weren't even creative aspects of the group. And, you know, there was just, you didn't want that lack of control. So the concept of Wolfpac was to make it so it was this ever evolving mutation. And it's continued since.
Dope. And now you guys have evolved into what you are right now. And what's that latest album you guys got? Square Peg Round Hole?
Square Peg Round Hole, self-released, which was a big first. I don't remember how many units we moved, probably like 6 or 7, but that's okay. And it's just that the concept is, again, it's the concept of where we were as Bloodhound Gang, where we are as people, where we are as juggalos, where we are as human beings. We don't fit in anywhere. We never have. We, you know, back in the day of the Bloodhound Gang and even Wolfpac, nobody knew even where to put our CDs in the stores. when the albums were coming out. Like, how do you class, use your fingers? Is it rock? Is it? And what was funny is at the time when we were touring, we would play these places that had, like, we played, they literally flew us to Seattle to play this big, huge thing called the Gorge at George. And we were playing with Brandy and Skilo.
With Wilkinson Brandy?
And
sorry.
R. Kelly. Yeah, like Bloodhound Gang and R. Kelly. It just doesn't mix. It's,
oh, shit.
But that was the thing. Nobody knew where to put the Bloodhound Gang. Same thing with Wolfpac. You know, is it metal? No. We played Manuji Metal Meltdown, this gigantic festival. It's, you know, all these guys walking around like corpse face paint and, like, you know, King Diamond and, you know, all these, all this. And what's funny is on that same event, Twisted was booked, and they left. They just left. They were like, fuck this. We're not supposed to be here. It was a fuck up by the booking agent who thought this stuff could cross over into metal. Right. We had no idea why we were there. We went on, and we just basically showed up, and we're like, hey, we're Wolfpac. We don't know why we're here either, but here's some strippers. And we basically kind of walked to the back, and we hired more strippers for the day. Had the strippers kind of go up to, we just went to this little place in Jersey and just literally hired strippers from this club to come out with our girls. And then our mask guys just went in the pit and started, like, really, really, really causing, like, violent fights amongst the metalheads. And they all thought we were great, even though we were rapping and weren't playing a single instrument, but whatever.
Holy shit, that sounds like quite a show, man.
It was definitely a show. We lit part of the carpet on fire because one of our fire breathers dropped something on the carpet. And they thought it was great. It was so funny because, like, at the time, our DJ was the guy that we brought on the Howard Stern show, who our DJ at the time, he was so into metal. He was really, really into metal. But because he knew he was playing the Metal Meltdown, he dressed like Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince. Like, he went and got an Adidas suit. Like, he tried purposely to piss off the metalheads. So it was great.
Oh, wow. Actually, man, that kind of a good segue into this question. Now, where does the girls of Wolfpac come from?
Well, again, man, it's like, I love beautiful women. I think the reason why me and Jim first started doing music was the attempt to get laid. We started a band called Bang Chamber 8, which was like a really horrible Cure meets Depeche Mode meets like long sweaters, eyeliner stuff. This is like when we were like 16. So, you know, this was, and the idea was we would get laid by gothic chicks. It didn't work at all. And we just felt stupid as hell. Because, you know, look at both of us. I mean, come on. It doesn't sell. It doesn't work. So there we are looking like idiots. And we sort of went, well, let's start doing music that we want to do. And, of course, that evolved later on, years later. And we always kind of had girls with us. And we brought some girls on Stern. And we brought some girls with us. And next thing, you know, it's just sort of like natural for us to bring not one, not two. But let's, you know, we have three or four girls. Let's bring them on for with us. Let's put them on. Let's not even just put them on. Let's develop them. Let them become famous. Let's build these girls with talent, like J. Joe Lee. Like, let this girl, like, won 3 AVN porn awards, for God's sake, just from her connections through the music industry. And that's kind of the funny part, is the music industry seems to open doors to every other industry. Like, we just did and I can't talk about it, but you'll be seeing it soon. We just did a walk-on a TV show. It'll air probably in about a week, something like that, you know, in the very end of December. But you will see that this music industry somehow opens up all these other doors. So the girl thing just came natural. Next thing I know is I'm approached by a guy from a company that I will not mention, who's a, you know, top 5 selling adult company, and they would back a movie for us. So we shot it, and we got nominated for Best Pro-Am by the AVN Awards. And then while we were at the AVN Awards, I was like, man, we got to do more of this because this business is easy. There's a lot of money here and there's a lot of hot chicks. And, you know, there's no way any of these girls would normally touch us. Just none. None okay. Whatsoever. Normally these girls would be, we would be on the receiving end of mace. You know what I'm saying?
Right, right. I hear
so
you.
Basically what ended up happening was we just sort of kind of put more into it, a little bit more into it. And the fans seemed to dig it because they wanted to see more of these girls that we were with. Like, you know, you bring the girl with you who's the hot chick and she's dancing. You know, somebody wants to see her boob. All right, cool. Sorry. Next thing you know, we're producing all these movies and, you know, having some fun. And what did we get? Our other nomination was while we were at the very first AVN Awards, they had category for most extreme sex act. And it was like something, it was so lame. It was like girl with roller skate. It was something so fucking lame. I hope I can say fucking.
Oh, you're good.
It was so douchebag. It was like, how is this an extreme sex act? So, like, we did that first AVN. We went back to this place called the Circle Bar and the Venusia. And we were all sitting around, all our crew. And I'm like, we could school this fucking extreme sex act. Let's fucking do something nuts. I'm like, let's hang someone from fucking hooks. Let's do a body suspension sex scene. Nobody's ever fucking done this before. So we do our research. Nobody's done it. I find out my buddy Mark Pantalone, who works for Wax, who used to be a guy who worked for, like, I don't know if you're familiar with professional wrestling, but he used to work for CZW and 3PW. Really great dude. Mark does body suspensions. I call him up and goes, I said, Mark, look, I want to hang somebody like 40 feet in the air, two people, and I want them to fuck. Can you do that?
He's like, yeah, man.
So I'm like, now all we got to do is find somebody crazy enough to do it. And Jay, the girl, one of our Wolfpack girls, was like, I'll fucking do it in a heartbeat. I was like, for real? She's like, yeah, 4-point suspension. Fuck, we put it up. And then we sat around, we talked to a couple pieces of male talent, and we found this kid. Guy was like 22, and he was like dumber than a brick. He's a very nice dude, but he was so, I don't know, man. He's just really, really weird dude, sketchy dude. I said, he wanted to be in the porn industry. He already did 3 or 4 scenes in L.A. I said, hey, man, this is what we want to do. We want to do a body suspension. You're going to be on, like, a 4-point suspension. She's going to be a 4-point suspension. You guys are going to be fucking, like, 50 foot in the air. And most of the body weight's going to be on you because you're the one fucking. Like, you're the one. She's going to have her legs wrapped around you. He's like, I got it, man. I said, got it. Next thing I know, we filmed it. We got nominated for Best Most Extreme Sex Act. And we lost.
What?
We lost to a movie called Night of the Giving Head. And the reason we lost, we found out many years later, the reason we lost is because all AVN is the companies that win the awards are the companies who book the most ads with the AVN magazine. Had I known that, just to get the award, I would have probably booked an ad with the magazine, just for the fuck of it, you know what I'm saying?
Right, right.
I had no idea. It's sort of like a payback. And they were very honest about it, but of course, if they'll deny it if you ask them about it, like, personally. They'll be like, oh, no, it's, the best movies and blah, blah, blah. No, it's whatever company spent the most money on their ads, and next thing you know. Because there's literally the Night of Giving Dead is, like, three girls dressed like they're green, and they're walking around sort of like zombies. And of course, we've got – and by the way, our next idea was we were going to put somebody in a shark cage during, like, their put them in shark-infested water, pull them out of the cage and have them fucking while it was her time of the month. In Shark Fest order. And we just said, at that point, the porn industry was almost dead. Porn is given away for free now. Nobody buys porn anymore.
Holy shit, man. Who is it that comes up with these ideas? Is this you?
It's pretty much me and Buddha. Buddha has been with me since pretty much like the second or third, well, about the second conception of Wolfpac, something in the area of 2001. He used to be a masked guy, and then he was a DJ, and he stepped up as an MC, and he's been sort of my right-hand man ever since, and that guy's creative as fuck. He always sees things in a very different way than I do, so I make it bad, and then he makes it worse. It's perfect.
Well, hells yeah, man. I'd like to get him on the podcast, too, so maybe pass that along to him.
Sure, absolutely.
How did you all get hooked up with ICP and Psychopathic Records?
So this is a long time ago when we used to tour under the Bloodhoung Gang. People used to come around and hand out, demo tapes and flyers. This is probably right before Riddle Box is going to come out, something in that area. They were playing a place called the Magic Stick in Michigan. It's like the Magic Stick, the Magic Bag, the Magic something. There's like 4 venues under the same name. Some people gave us some flyers. And lo and behold, we had no idea who it was at the time because you have to remember there was no internet. Imagine no internet. Imagine a world with no internet.
I lived there at one time.
See? So there's no internet. Nobody, there's AOL. There's Spin Magazine online. There was like those kind of like online services. So these kids drop off these flyers and a couple cassette tapes. One of them was just Carnival Carnage. And both me and Jim were listening to, we always listen to stuff. That's how music spread back then, was people handing cassettes. Like Metallica got signed off of a demo handed to another band. So this is how you discovered some crazy shit. And of course, you look at this thing, you're like, fucking clowns who rap? This is hysterical. Yeah, why wouldn't we? Next thing we know, we're listening to like Evil Clowns Who Rap, even fucking better. Yes. That was about it, man. We never really saw them or talked to them or ever, since that point. I left Bloodhound Gang, started doing the Sugar Daddy stuff, started doing the Wolfpac stuff. We wrote a zine because back in the day, magazines, independent magazines, were sort of, again, the way that you got the word out. You had a mailing list and you sent out these, mailers, promos. So I was like, fuck, man. We're sitting in the studio, me and at the time, this guy by the name of MSJ. And this commercial comes on. It's like 4 a.m. We're watching MTV, and a commercial comes on, and it's a fucking Riddle Box commercial. And it's the dancing fucking, the fucking, and it's going back and forth, and we're like, and then they start cutting in scenes of the chicken hunting video. And I'm like, what the fuck? Oh my God, I know who the fuck this is. This is fucking ICP. Right. I know exactly who this is. Tried to get Riddle Box in my area. Couldn't get it. Nobody had it because, you know, it was Jive sort of fucked them over. But Philadelphia is like a dead music town, man. Unless you're famous, it doesn't come here. It's very, you see what I'm saying? Like, you're either famous and it comes here, or you're too famous and you're a sellout, you get out of here. That's how I feel. Philadelphia is jaded as hell. Anyways, reached out to Psychopathic, said, hey, man, love to interview you guys for the zine. They obliged. The next thing I know is, you know, we're having a conversation 2 days later. And about a week later, me and MSD drove out to the studio, drove out to the old office, and hung out with, you know, Joe and Joey and Alex and everybody. We've been friends ever since. And the cool thing about that is we are always friends before business. That's how my whole concept of doing business is, you know, when people tell you it's nothing personal, it's just business.
Right.
For me, it's always personal, man. It's always friendship before anything. I've had a lot of money and I've been poor. And to me, none of that matters. What matters is sort of being kind of good people to each other. And like, you know, even though most people think I'm a giant asshole, which is fine with me.
Have you ever made any decisions that you've regretted because of that, that philosophy?
No, not really, man. Life is, from how I exist, I don't think there's even a bad decision ever. I think, you know, as long as you're learning from your strife, as long as you're taking away something, you know, from it, whatever it is, even things that are really, really negative. You know, Nietzsche said it, you know, it doesn't kill you, makes you stronger, but it goes even with, you know, you can take that back all the way to Romans 5:3, but biblical error type stuff where, you know, take comfort in this strife because it makes you as a person. So I don't think there's ever a bad decision. You learn from that, right? There's a reason for that to happen. What did you say in that one movie? You, Batman, you fall down so you can learn how to get up.
That's it. Yeah. Why do we fall? So we learn to pick ourselves back up. That's right.
Absolutely. That's some very, that goes back to biblical type stuff. So I don't think in my estimate, it's always worked well for me. Have I missed opportunities? Probably. Could I have cut throats and done, you know, yeah, but who, you know, at the end of the day, I gotta be able to sleep and have a comfortable night's sleep and, you know, not worry about the bad things I did to anybody. You know what I mean?
Hell yeah, man. You know what? That's a good philosophy to live by for sure.
Yeah, life's too short to be negative, man. You know, you blink and it's over. So,
right.
So that's it, man. We've been friends ever since. And, you know, like I said, I consider the juggalo thing when people explain it to me, when me and Joe were talking about it, how it was evolving and how it was evolving. It wasn't the band making it. It was becoming itself. It, to me, it was very reminiscent of early days of punk rock. It's the kids that don't fit anywhere, the kids that don't care to fit in anywhere. It wasn't that we didn't fit in and we were like, oh, we want to fit in. It's like, ah, fuck fitting in, fuck that. We don't even care. We're gonna go off and do our own thing over here. That was like the old school punk rock, the old school hardcore, the old school rap, and the old school vibe. To me, that was juggalo. I was like, well, dude, that's all we are. That's exactly what Wolfpack and Bloodhound Gang is. We've never fit anywhere. None of us fit anywhere. So fuck it. Nothing, birds of a feather just kind of flock together, right?
So it is Christmas Eve. So what was one of them bomb-ass Christmas presents you remember getting as a kid?
You know, it's so funny. I guess probably the best thing that I ever got was, and of course I'm old, so I'm dating myself. I asked for this so many times, and it never happened, but I finally got, I woke up in the morning, and I came downstairs and there was Mattel's in television. Do you remember in television?
Television?
It's called In Television. It was a video game system created by Mattel, and it was like the antithesis to Atari. So if you had Atari, I had In Television. And In Television had all these crazy other games. Like, it had like fucked up weird math and science games, but it had like speech synthesizers. It had all this stuff, and it always ripped off major arcade games. So like, it didn't have Asteroids. It had a game called Astro Smash, which was like Space Invaders meets Asteroids. And why I wanted this, because there was this thing going on. I was really good at video games as a kid because they were very simple and I'm a pretty simple guy. I got this fucking thing and I practiced on and on for months this game called Astro Smash, because they were doing a competition in Texas, like a big competition. And the prize was like $7,000 for the Astro Smash winner. Like, and of course, it was supposed to go to your college education. And Lord knows, back then, you know, $7,000 was a lot. Nowadays, you know, with $7,000, you can't even, I think it's your books in college.
Right.
In any case, I got my Astro Smash. I actually got a high score. I sent it in, and I never heard back anything. I was told that I did not win, and I just my score wasn't good enough. I had to take a Polaroid of the fucking screen, which I still have. Well, many years later, in 2003, my father died. Many years later, clearing out his files, his office, I find an envelope, a folder with a patch and a welcome letter to the competition in Texas. I was one of like 60 kids chosen.
Oh, you're kidding me.
No, but because it cost like $400 to fly in hotels and stuff, my father was we weren't low class, but we weren't high class, but we weren't middle class. My father was a cop out of New York, so we were very, you know, check to check, if you will, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
So my father kind of just buried it and kind of was, although I probably could have won the $7,000, it didn't matter, you know, it just sort of disappeared. But, you know, I understand why my father did it. But millions of years later, I found out that I could have been in the freaking Intel Astro Smash competition, and I got asked out somehow. Oh, well.
Oh, well, man. That's not a very happy Christmas story.
Well, I still had fun with the game, man. It was, you know what it was? It wasn't the destination. It was the drive, man. You know what I'm saying?
Right, right. All right. That's a good way to look at it.
Yeah.
All right, man. Final question before we take off here, brother, and I ask this every episode. You're deserted on a desert island.
Okay.
And you have a Discman. And you have 3 CDs with you. What 3 CDs do you have?
This is easy, man. Okay, so the Misfits, which would be, the album would be Walk Among Us. It would be ICP's Riddle Box. And it would be Wu-Tang Clan's 36 Chambers.
Wow, man. That was a pretty fast answer, too.
Yeah, because, I love music, man. And I have my classics. And you can't, like, even though I like newer stuff all the time, you still got to go back to your roots, man. You got to put that old stuff in and go, yes. Like when ICP just came through on tour and they were, you know, doing the Riddle Box tour, seeing them do 12 live was amazing. Like,
right.
And, you know, we just had the Misfits reunion, 2 shows. We flew out, did the Denver show. We did the Denver, and to see the lineup of the Misfits live, the Glenn Danzeri only fucking Doyle live. You got to go back to your roots, brother.
Well, 100% agree with all 3 of those releases, man. All right, man. Is there anything that you want to let all the fans know before we take off here?
Just thank you guys so much for the many years of support. Thank you guys for being down, you know, and keeping it positive. There's a lot of negativity in the world all the time, but, you know, fuck all that. Just keep the PMA going and just do what you do, man, and do what you do for the reason that you do it. And just thank you guys so much for being, you know, supportive of this whole scene wouldn't exist if it wasn't for the fans. There's no major radio. There's no major video. There's no nothing like that. It's all about the people. So we just, our hats are off to y'all.
Hell damn, man. Well, we really appreciate it, Daddy Longlegs.
Not a problem.
You have yourself a great night, brother.
Yeah, you have yourself a good Christmas, man.
Oh, yeah, exactly. Have a good Christmas, man. Christmas
have
tomorrow.
A happy Kwanzaa Hanukkah, or whatever they have, the 4 other ones I don't know about.
On the 12th day of Christmas, my true love came to me. 12 dead chicken boys, 11 stinky bitches, 10 bigots dying, 9 mothers bitching, 8 crackhead babies, 7 redneck moes, 6 bunting bodies, 5 cases of Faygo.
That is going to do it for this episode of the Faygoluvers Podcast. I want to give a big thank you to our homie Daddy Longlegs for coming on and talking to us, especially this time of the holidays. And don't forget to hit up wolfpacmerch.com. And there is a link in the show notes of this episode for you ninjas who want to check it out. Next episode of the Faygoluvers Podcast, we're going to have Fresh Kid Ice of 2 Live Crew. They got a compilation coming out on Chinaman Records, and I'm going to talk to him about that, along with 2 Live Crew itself. Hells yeah, and I have a lot of interesting questions already set up for that shit, so tune in for that. Have you ninjas ever heard of these juggalos that call themselves the Spirits of the Dark Carnival? They are going to have a segment on the Faygoluvers Podcast starting on the next episode, and I'm not going to tell you anything about it other than that. You're going to have to tune in and see for yourself. I promised you guys a New Year's episode, and I don't know if I mentioned or not, but Scotty D was actually supposed to come on and host it with me, co-host it with me. Unfortunately, I'm not going to be doing that. What my plan was I was going to show you guys a bunch of unused material. There's a bunch of dope shit, like I got some shit of Vinny the ICP Kid talking about how he started collecting. I got a Rude Boy talking about how he originally met ICP. Just dope shit like that, like unused shit that I was going to put out, but I decided I'm not going to do that. I don't have enough material for a full episode, I feel, and I don't want to use songs as fillers because this is a podcast, so no New Year's episode. Send me a 4 or 5 star review on iTunes, and I will read it on this podcast. You have any comments, questions, concerns, anything that you want read on the air, hit me up, Rosco@Faygoluvers.net. I am going to continue watching the 1994 holiday classic, Serial Mom. That actually has nothing to do with Christmas, but I started watching it last night, and I want to finish it. You ninjas, have yourself a Merry Christmas, and remember to keep an open mind. Peace.
1-1-1-1. Yeah. Now we're slashing through the snow on a bloodstained broken sleigh. Twister Blaze, ROC, Lavelle, and Wolfpac, we're killing all the way. Now you're home alone, don't play Macaulay McCulkin. Fuck the puffin' on the chronic straight and mistletoe we smoking. I ain't joking, can I get amen? For us, a reason for the season is for murder and mayhem. Silent night, that's when I creep like Santa Claus, sneaking down the chimney. Get your cookies and your money, pack it up and I'm gone. Jingle bells, no bitch, that's my cell phone. I'm a Grinch in a pinch, give a mile, take an inch. I'ma leave a little bit for the kids, that's it. No more, ho ho, let's go. What's the dough with the gifts in my coat? Ho.
Drink and smoke it, let's get high. Because it's Christmas and the fucking bitches that ain't fly. Because it's Christmas and the double-headed axes and knives. Because it's Christmas and the stabbing, killing, time to die. Because it's Christmas and the hood.
That's all the balls stuck in their beds, but it was vengeance and naked bitches atop of my head. Don't give a fuck about sugar plums and none of that dumb shit. All I really care about is violence, bitches, and bomb hits. And that's about all my wish list consists of. Cut all the crap, just get to the good stuff. The east side, does it, you'll die right. Merry Christmas to all, and to all a good night.
We wish you a scary Christmas.
Christmas.
We wish you a scary Christmas.
Christmas.
That's why Santa had to miss ya. Cause we got him right here.
Boom, boom.
And that ringing that you hear ain't them bells clinging. It's the fire from the signal that we all bringing. It's the Wolfpac Blaze, Lavelle twisted in ROC, yelling at the world, fill it with bodies, more bodies for real.
Drink and smoke it, let's get high. Because it's Christmas in the fucking bitches that ain't fly. Because it's Christmas in the double-headed axes and knives. Because it's Christmas in the stabbing, killing, time to die.
Jingle bell, jingle bell, jingle bell rock. You can swallow my cum after sucking my cock. So yeah. I shimmy down the chimney all covered in snow. Merry Clitch is what I leave when it's time to go.
Yeah.
Take a walk through my winter wonder pants as we dance. We retire by the fire, get high first chance. Freak don't expire by your classy rich bitch. Just hook up the gifts and have a mad fat Christmas.
Oh ho, the mistletoe. Who wanna try kiss a killer who likes cereal? Marshmallows in my teeth, I'm huddled up by the fireplace, wrapped in a Pokemon bed sheet, waiting for Fatty to bring my gifts. I only want a quest of Fonny and some panties made of licorice. Amigo Hall of Justice brand new in a box, in a track from an oxide featuring Tupac.
Drink and smoke it, let's get high. Because it's Christmas and the fucking bitches that ain't fly. Because it's Christmas and the double-headed axes and knives. Because it's Christmas and the stabbing, killing, time to die. Because it's Christmas
and the snowman, aka the pot of kids, slanging bowlers in your alone with candy cane sticks. You need a fix, so I got that shit falling out my pocket. So feeling a gun on the market, no one can stop. They can stop, and I'm the dealer on the corner, that's a game. Things chasing me with black 14 or the bank. Even Mrs. Claus is one of my best custodes. Her and Breeze, my second lose up on the Bobo. You better watch out, you better not cry. This Christmas Eve, everybody's gonna die. Eggnog ladles full of blood and guts. I'm at the North Pole with Santa Claus, fucking little elf sluts. Smoking weed with the misfit toys on some island, stealing shit straight wildin'. Quit crying, little bitch, it's Christmas. Now step aside while I talk, kiss your missus.
Drink and smoke and let's get high. Because it's Christmas and the fucking bitches that ain't fly. Because it's Christmas and the double-headed axes and knives. Because it's Christmas and the stabbing, killing, time to die. Because it's Christmas.
Christmas is for homos. I celebrate with no one but this bottle of SoCo. For 1 week, everyone everyone's kissing and loving me, but the rest of the year everyone's pushing and shoving me. I got a dark past, the kids don't know that, but on Christmas it's fun to sit on the fat guy's lap. You want dolls and Legos, little girls? Let's go, got a joystick for you when it's not Nintendo.
If I start burbling and slurring, it's probably because I'm like halfway awake, but that's okay. Don't mind me. I'll just let me tucker myself out in the corner and I'll be fine.
Yeah, I think that makes for a more entertaining interview anyways, right?
Exactly. So. If your interviewees are actually drooling on themselves at one point, you're good. You know you've done your job.